Welcome to Higher Structure Seminar Series. Today, our speaker is Felix Dabaton from Max Planck Institute for Mathematics in Bonn, and he will talk on Lux univalence for omega categories. So we thank Felix for giving this talk. Yeah, please. Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you for the invitation. I'm really glad to speak here. I will speak today on Lax univalence for omega category. And I will start with a small warning. So today I will use a lot the language of infinity one category, and so to keep the notations shorter, I will remove the indexed infinity. So it means that, for example, today groupoid will always mean infinity groupoid. Category will always mean infinity one category. And so on. So for example, two categories are infinity two categories, etc., etc. So if you are not comfortable with this, you can just suppose that I'm talking about strict category, and it should be enough. Okay, so as an introduction, I want to recall some important facts about the theory of groupoid. And more precisely, I want to recall one important theorem, and two consequences of this theorem that I will generalize to the setting of omega category later. So the theorem that I want to recall is the Grothendieck construction. So in order to state it, I need a small notation. I denote JRD, the groupoid of small groupoid. Okay. Now, the Grothendieck constructions state that for A, a groupoid, we have an equivalence between morphisms from A to the groupoid of small groupoid and the groupoid of groupoid over A. Okay, so these two groupoid, so yeah, here I need to put to take the maximal groupoid. So it means that, for example, this is the groupoid whose objects are just morphisms over A of groupoid. Okay, so I have an equivalence between these two groupoid. The morphisms that go from left to right is just the Grothendieck constructions, and the other one, the inverse, is called the Grothendieck deconstructions. Okay. So in fact, in this case, I can describe these two functors. They are not, it's not too complicated. So for example, suppose I'm starting from a functor from A to the groupoid of small groupoid. So, okay, I need to construct a morphisms over A. So how can I do this? First, I take the coproduct over all elements of A of the value of F on A. I can project this onto the coproduct over all elements of A of the terminal groupoid. And in fact, this is equivalent to A. Okay, so I have construct my morphisms from left to right. And for the other side, so suppose I'm starting from P, from X to A. Okay, so I need to construct a functor, okay, that send an element, sorry, yeah. So yeah, the other functor send an element A of A onto the fiber of P over A. So what does that mean by this? Where XA fit in the following pullback. So here I have the morphisms corresponding to the point A. Here I have my X and I take the pullback. Okay, so this is how we construct the two inverse. Yeah, this is the idea, huh? Because in fact, if you want to do it, we need to be a little bit more careful, but anyway. So yeah. Okay, so this is the theorem that I wanted to recall, and now two observations. So the first one is called the univalence. So let F, G be two morphisms from A to the groupoid of small groupoid, two functors. Okay, so with F and G, I can construct the two following diagrams. So I have two morphisms from A to groupoid, F and G, and here I have my two Grothendieck constructions. And the univalence states that there is an equivalence of groupoid between invertible natural transformations between F and G. This is equivalent to equivalence between Y and X over A. So in fact, this is really a consequence of the Grothendieck construction because in fact, this is a path in morphisms from A to groupoid. And this is a path in groupoid over A. Okay. Yeah, so a small historic remark, like the name univalence comes from the fact that there is like a really similar axiom in type theory, which is called univalence, and which is exactly saying this, in fact. So this is why I call this like this. Okay, so it was the first thing that I wanted to remember. And the second one is the following, is the link that it exists between the Grothendieck constructions and the coproduct. So let F from A to groupoid be any morphisms. We have an equivalence between the coproduct over A of F of A and the domain of the Grothendieck constructions of F. So this is, by the way, I define the Grothendieck construction. This is totally obvious. In fact, I define the Grothendieck constructions like this. But still, I wanted to emphasize on this because it will be important for the following. Okay, so now I just explained my theorem and the two consequences. And the goal today is to generalize all these phenomena from groupoid to omega category. Okay, so for example, the groupoid of small groupoid will become omega with a bar like this, which is the omega category of small omega category. So previously, to define the Grothendieck constructions, I use the notion of morphisms over A. So in the setting of omega category, it will not be enough, and I will need to consider left Cartesian fibrations. Over A. Okay, this is the analog of morphisms over A. The univalence in this new setting will be called the lax univalence. Okay, which is the reason why, of the title of these presentations. And eventually, for example, we use the coproduct just before. And so the analog in omega category will be the much more complicated notion of lax colimit. Okay, so the purpose of today is to explain what all these things mean and to relate some phenomena to the one that I just explained. Okay, so this is the end of the introductions. And now I can define omega category. So the definition that I will give is a little bit informal, but I think it should be enough for today to have like some idea of these constructions. So definitions: an omega category C is a data of for every integer n. I have a groupoid of n cell, a groupoid Cn of n cell. Okay. I have associative Operations of compositions. I can compose myself. Okay, and eventually, I have units operations. So I'm going to give like some example, for example, for the compositions operations. So for example, suppose that I have two cell like this. So I have alpha and beta. So two cell. I can compose them to get a new two cell, which is called alpha, sorry, alpha one compose with beta. Okay. So I put it is a one composition because the gluing is performed onto a cell of dimension one. But I also have a zero composition. So I start from this, for example, alpha and beta. And now I can construct a new two cell, which is beta zero compose with alpha. Okay. So once again, it is a zero composition because the gluing is performed onto a cell of dimension zero. And so on. I have this in all dimensions. And these operations are associative, and this is the moment where it becomes a little bit more tricky to really define what does it mean. But we can do it like we do with a normal one category, in fact. We have a more complicated combinatorics, but the spirit is the same. Okay, so we have our compositions operations, and we also have units. And units are functors from Cn to Cn plus 1 that send a cell A onto the unit of A. Okay. And as you can guess, this is just a unit for the compositions operations. Okay, so we have this notion of omega category, which is like the kind of natural generalizations of the notion of category. In fact, we construct category, we have two categories, three categories. And here we just take, in fact, the limit of this kind of tower of enrichment. So now I'm going to give several examples of omega category. So it will be a little bit some toy examples. In fact, it will be the example that I will use today. Yeah, perhaps not the more interesting, but so for example, I have the terminal omega category, which corresponds to the point. Okay. I also have, I see that someone perhaps want to ask a questions.
Yes. Is there a vertical and horizontal composition interchange law for tree morphism in this structure?
Alors, so for example, so I don't know if it is what you were thinking about, but for example, imagine I start from this diagram. I can compose it on two different ways. So first, I can do the one composition of these two cells and the one composition of these two cells, and I will get. Two cells like this. Okay. And now I can do a zero compositions and I get one, only one big one cell. But I can also go in the other directions. So first I do the zero composition of this one with this one and of this one with this one. And I get two cells. And after I can perform one compositions. And this square should commute.
Okay. How about tree morphism, tree cells?
But we have the same thing with the same kind of axiom for every dimensions. For example, in fact, so yeah. Sorry, I need to erase a little bit. Oh, no. Yeah, so for example, what we have for every K strictly inferior to n, we have a morphisms like this. So this is two n cells that share a common K cell, and we have a K compositions. So this is the K compositions. So for example, we can do like a two composition of three cells, one composition of three cells, etc. Does it answer the question or not at all?
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, so now for like the examples. So yeah, I have my terminal category. And I have also, so this one is a directed interval. So it corresponds to the following diagram. I have 2 points and one morphism between these 2 points. I also have D2, which is a two globe, and which correspond to the following diagram. So I have 2 1-cell and 1 2-cell. I can continue, and I have D3, which correspond to this diagram. So I have 2 2-cell and 1 3-cell between both. And in fact, I can continue. This is there is a kind of a recursive principle here, and I can define for all n the n globe that I denote dn. Okay, so these are the examples that I will use a lot today. Okay, so this is the definition of omega category. And now I'm going to talk about something which is really important for omega category, which is the Gray cylinder. There's a Gray tensor product, an incarnation of the Gray tensor product. So this is the theorem that I show in my thesis. So there exists a unique co-continuous functor that I denote like this, so with the O time, which is called the Gray cylinder. N such that its value onto the terminal omega category is just the directed interval. Its value onto the directed interval is a square that commutes up to a 2-cell. Okay. Its value on D2, so D2 was, I remember, was this omega category. Its value on D2 corresponds to the following diagram. And so on. Okay, so some remark. So as you can see, in fact, the Gray cylinder is a kind of topological cylinder, but where we want to put an orientations onto every face of the cylinder. So the second remark is like there is a kind of pattern in these constructions, and when I put and so on, I mean that we can define the expected value of the Gray cylinder onto all n globe. And the thing which is like this theorem is just saying that the Gray cylinder is totally characterized by its value onto the n globe. Okay, so we define it on the n globe and we can extend it to every omega category, which is like rare in fact, because it means that we doesn't need to precise what the composite are. In fact, we have no choice. Okay. So we can define our Gray cylinder, which is this kind of directed cylinder. And the question is, why do we need to define such an operations? And in fact, this operation is really useful, where it's like we have to define it in order to define the notion of Lax natural transformations. So definitions of Lax natural transformations. So let F, G from A to B be two functors between two omega categories. The groupoid of Lax natural transformations that we denote Lax FG is the groupoid of diagram of the following shape. Okay. So I can construct I have two morphisms from A to B, which correspond to F and G. And I have two inclusions of A onto A, onto the gray cylinder of A. Okay, that correspond to the left side and the right side. So in order to precise this, I'm going just to write this gray tensor product with the point zero. And here, gray tensor product with the point one. Okay, so I have my two functor FG and a Lax natural transformation between F and G is the data of homomorphisms from the gray cylinder of A to B, whose restrictions onto zero is F and onto one is G. So if we unfold the definitions, it means that psi correspond to the following data. So for every A, in A, we have a morphism from FA to GA. And for every morphisms F from A to B in A, we have a square. We have a square that commutes up to a two cell. Okay, so it's like a normal natural transformations, but that commute up to a two cell, and so on. Okay, so we have like similar axiom for every for two morphisms of A, three morphisms, etc., etc. Okay, and so why do we need to define the notion of Lax natural transformations? In fact, we need to define it in order to define Lax colimit. And now I can define Lax colimit. Let F from A to B a functor. The Lax colimit of F, if it exists, the data of an object which is called Lax colim of F over A, and for all objects C of B, an equivalence between, so I take morphisms in B between the Lax colim of F and C, and Lax natural transformations between F and the constant functor with value C. So I define Lax natural over Lax colimit exactly as I would have defined normal colimit, just by replacing natural transformation by Lax colimit, Lax natural transformations. So what does it mean? It means, for example, that for every A, we have morphisms between FA and the Lax colim of F. For every morphisms A between A and B, we have triangles. But this triangle is not commutative. It commutes up to a two cell. Okay? And so on. Okay. So we have this notion of Lax colimit that we build using the notion of Lax natural transformation. But in fact, the problem is that when we want to use Lax colimit when we are doing category theory, higher category theory, this notion of Lax colimit is a little bit too rigid, in fact, not enough flexible. And we would like to have a notion where we can ask that some of these triangles are commutative and not up to a two cell, are really commutative. And in fact, we would like to have a theory which is in between this notion of Lax colimit, which is like really, really rigid, and the notion of Lax colimit, where like all of these triangles commute, something in between. And this is the reasons to introduce the notion of marked omega category, of marked omega category, and so marked omega category. So marked omega category. So I'm sorry to give like yet another one definition, but this one should be is not too hard. A marked category is a pair si TC where C is an omega category and TC is in fact a sequence is a sequence of full subspace of the full subgroupoid of the groupoid of Hensel. And this, so TC is called the marking. Okay, and a cell which is in TC is called marked. Yeah, and so we have like two conditions on this marking. This marking is stable by compositions. And include units. Okay, so to sum up, a marked omega category is just a pair CT, is just in fact the data of a normal omega category where some cells are distinguished, in fact. And we want that distinguished cell, which are the marked cell, are stable by compositions and that all of the units are distinguished. Okay. So first observation, which is like a kind of straightforward, we have two canonical ways to mark an omega category. So we have a triplet of adjunctions. So the first canonical way is called flat, and the second one is sharp. And we have one canonical functor from the category of marked omega category to omega category, which is called natural. So I need to describe a little bit these two markings. So flat is a functor that marks the less possible. So in fact, only the units are going to be marked. And sharp is the one that marks everything. So the more possible. Okay. So the two markings, the trivial one and the maximal one. And the functor natural is just the normal forgetful functor. In fact, natural just forgets the marking. Okay. Okay, so I've defined marked omega category. I have like this canonical way to mark an omega category. And now I need to define a kind of analog of the gray cylinder in this new setting. So I'm not going to define it precisely because it's a little bit complicated, but I'm going to give like the kind of the recipe to build this. So we define a concontinuous functor, which is so oui, which is the marked gray cylinder. So which is a functor that we denote like this. So gray tensor product with the directed interval sharp that go from marked omega category to omega category, to marked omega category, sorry, by the following formula. So for example, the value of the marked gray cylinder on ATA is the following marked omega category. So I need to define the underlying omega category. So I start from the gray cylinder of A, and I'm going to crush some cell that depend of the marking TA. Okay, I will give some example just in few seconds. So I crush some cell, and the marking will depend on TA. Okay. So for example, I can give in fact the definition of this onto the two canonical way to mark an omega category. So for example, if I start from the directed interval flat, so the one where nothing is marked, I get a square that commutes up to a two cell. And the marked cell corresponds to this one. So this one is marked, this one is marked, and this one is marked. Okay, so it's just the gray cylinder plus marking. But now, if I do the marked gray cylinder of one of the directed interval sharp, so the one where everything is marked, I get a square which is commutative this time. And where everything is marked. So I crush the two cell. In fact, with this relation, in fact, I crush the two cell. And this is true in a much bigger generality. So for example, if I start from an omega category trivially marked, C flat, and I apply the gray cylinder and I forget the marking. So the underlying category, omega category of the marked gray cylinder of C flat is just the gray cylinder of C. But the underlying category of the gray cylinder of C sharp is the gray, sorry, is the Cartesian product of C with the directed interval. And in fact, so the idea that I want to communicate somewhere is that this marking gives us a kind of flexibility on how gray we want this operation to be. The more we mark and the less gray it is. And for example, if we mark nothing, it is like totally gray. And if we mark no, if we marked all the cell, we just get the normal Cartesian product. So the slogan, sorry, is the following. At the level of the underlying omega category, by shifting the marking, we continuously move from the gray cylinder to what I'm going to call the Cartesian cylinder. Which is the Cartesian product with a directed interval. Okay, so we have this flexibility that we were looking for, in fact. And now we are going to reflect, in fact, this flexibility onto the notion of marked Lax natural transformations. So I'm going to, in fact, repeat all the things that I did using the gray cylinder with the marked gray cylinder. So I defined Lax natural transformations previously, and now I redefined it with the marking. So I start from two functors, FG, from A to B. Let TA be a marking on A. So the groupoid of marked Lax natural transformations. So this is two functors between omega category that are not marked. Just take we forget that these two functors doesn't know the marking. So the groupoid of marked Lax natural transformations that we denote Lax FG over TA is a groupoid of diagram of the following shape. So I start from A with the point zero. I have a functor from this to B, which is F. I have also a functor from A gray cylinder with one to B, which is G. And here, I take the underlying omega category of the marked gray cylinder of ATA. And this is a marked na Lax natural transformations. So I know that this is a little bit harder to parse, but I can give an example, in fact. Yeah, not an example, but I can unfold a little bit. So what does it mean, psi? In fact, psi is the data, is the following data. So for every A, so for all A, we have a morphism from FA to GA, like before. Okay. For every morphisms A to B, we have a square that commute up to a two cell, alpha F. But here is a novelty. Alpha F with alpha F being the identity whenever F is marked. Okay, so some of these square commutes and the commutative square correspond to the marked one cell of A. And so once again, we get some flexibility, in fact. And by shifting, by varying the marking, we decide like how many square commute and how many doesn't commute. And so what is the slogan? So I will say a lot of slogan today. So by shifting the marking, this notion of flux natural transformations, we continuously move from what I can call fully lax. Fully lax natural transformations to usual natural transformations. Okay, if we map everything, all of these square commute. Okay, and so we get all the variation in between. So we have a lot of expressivity, in fact. Okay, so this is really nice. And now we can define a new notion of a lax collimit, which will be like much better, in fact. So let f from A to B be a functor, and I take a marking, so a functor between omega category, which are not marked. Let TA be a marking on A. Okay, let TA be a marking on A. So the lax collimit of F over the marking TA is, if it exists, the data of an object which I'm going to call lax collim of F indexed by TA. Okay. And for all objects C, an equivalence between, so morphisms between the lax collimit of F over TA and, sorry, B and lax natural transformations between F and the constant functor with value B. Okay, so once again, is the same definition as before, but I just, yeah, lax TA. I just change my notions of lax natural transformations a little bit. So what does it mean? So for example, this means that for every A, I have a morphism from FA to the lax collimit of F over TA. For every morphism from A to B, I have a triangles. And these triangles commute up to a two cell. But now, with the marking, we have the following novelty. So this is alpha f. So alpha f is the identity whenever f is marked. Okay, and so we can choose, in fact, how many triangles commute. Yeah, and so lax collimit fulfills this property and is the initial that fulfills this property. And so what is the slogan, once again? By shifting the marking, in fact, we can continuously move from the kind of fully lax collimit. And if we mark everything, all of these triangles are going to commute, and so we get kind of a usual collimit. Okay, and we have all the things in between. Okay, so this is like a flexible theory. This is like what we are looking for when working with this. Okay, so this was the presentation of the theory of marked omega category. And so at the beginning, I recall like the Gray construct, sorry, the Grothendieck constructions for groupoid. And now I'm going to explain the Grothendieck constructions in this setting. So I just said at the beginning that we cannot, it's too naive to consider morphisms over omega category. We need a notion of left Cartesian fibrations, and this is what I'm going to define now. So a morphisms P from X to A sharp is a left Cartesian fibrations. If for every marked omega category C, si, sorry, every square of the following shape, so here, the inclusion sorry, of C onto the gray cylinder of C, the marked gray cylinder of C, here I have X, here I have A sharp. So if and only if every square of this shape admit a unique lifting. Okay, so this definition is not really enlightening, I think it's not really clear because the combinatorics of the gray cylinder is complicated. And so I'm going to give like some example in order to build some intuitions of these notions. So the first example, which is perhaps the more easy, what are left Cartesian fibrations over the terminal omega category? So morphisms over one, over the terminal omega category, is a left Cartesian fibrations if and only if X is trivially marked. So it means that X is equal to C flat for some omega category C. Okay, so a left Cartesian fibrations over a point is just a normal omega category with a trivial marking, but just a normal omega category. Okay, so now a more complicated example. So suppose I take F from C to D, a morphisms of omega category. So unmarked omega category, just normal omega category. The following morphisms is a left Cartesian fibration. So I take C, Cartesian product with the directed interval. So I take, sorry, C flat, Cartesian product with the directed interval sharp, coproduct over C flat with the point, and I do a gluing onto D flat. And I have a canonical morphism from C to one sharp. Okay, so I'm going to give like some, to do a small drawing. Okay, so this morphism, so we start from C. Here we have our D. Okay. And for every point X, we add a morphism from X to F of X. Okay. For every Y, we do the same. And each time we have, it creates square and the square are commutative. Okay, so we build this and we have a projection. I can send C onto zero, D onto one, and all these morphisms which are in between the morphism between zero and one. Okay, so this is the directed interval. And this is like, this is just this. Okay. So now for the marking, I need to precise the marking. In fact, here I'm going to mark all the morphisms from X to F of X. And here I'm going to mark just these morphisms. Okay, so this is this object. So the theorem, well, it's not the theorem, but the example. Is saying that this morphisms is a left Cartesian fibrations. But we have even better. Any left Cartesian fibrations, so I'm going to write LCF to for short. Any left Cartesian fibrations over one sharp is of this shape. So to sum up, a left Cartesian fibrations over a point is just a normal omega category. A left Cartesian fibrations over an interval is a morphisms between the two fibers. And so it gives an impression, and an impression which is totally correct, that a left Cartesian fibrations, in fact, is a family of omega category which are parameterized by the base B. And this is exactly what we are looking for. This is the content and this is the spirit, in fact, of the Grothendieck constructions. Okay. And now I'm going to give a last example. So I'm sorry, I need to relate this. So this is a last example for people that are like more used to Grothendieck op vibrations, but for the people that don't know this, you can just not listen. So a morphism speed between two marked one category. So by this, I mean by two marked strict category, strict one category, is a left Cartesian vibrations if and only if I forget the marking, I get a Grothendieck op vibrations. And second conditions, the marked cell of X correspond to Cartesian lifting. So what does it mean? It means, in fact, that left Cartesian fibrations are a generalization of Grothendieck op fibrations in a multi-dimensional way, but with one big modification. In fact, we want to keep track of the Cartesian lifting, in fact. And we are going to mark into the domain, yeah, the domain, all the Cartesian edge. But this is exactly the same spirit. This is just a technical difference. But yeah, still, it's like an important one because it means that a morphism between two left Cartesian fibrations, it preserves the marking, and so it means that it preserves the Cartesian edge. And it will be important. Okay, so now I can state the Grothendieck constructions, which was like in my thesis. So I need to define two things still. So I denote omega, the omega category of small omega category. And I denote L cart of A sharp, the category of left Cartesian fibrations over A sharp. So it means that morphisms are just left Cartesian fibrations. And morphisms are just commutative triangle of left Cartesian fibrations. So as I said earlier, it preserves Cartesian edge. But anyway, so yeah, we have our object and our morphisms. And now the Grothendieck constructions say that we have an equivalence between morphisms between A and the omega category of small omega category and left Cartesian fibrations over A sharp. So we have an equivalence. In this direction, this is called the Grothendieck constructions. And in the other one, it is the Grothendieck deconstructions. Okay. So, yeah, so it's not a Ohm, sorry, because it's a category. It's the category of functor between A and omega. So, in fact, we have something which is even better. We can promote this to an equivalence of omega category. We can define an omega category of functor and an omega category of left Cartesian fibrations. But it would have been a little bit too long to explain. Okay, so we have these Grothendieck constructions. So, really happy. And now I need to explain two other. Yeah, I need to speak about univalence. What is univalence in this new setting? So it's a little bit more technical, perhaps, but still the same idea. I start from two morphisms, Fg, from A to the omega category of small omega category. I take also a marking TA on A. Let TA be a marking on A. So in particular, I have a canonical inclusion from ATA onto A sharp. This morphism is just the identity at the level of the omega category. We just change the marking. So this is iota. And we denote iota as the canonical inclusions. Okay. So with F, G, and iota, we can build, in fact, several diagrams. So first, I'm going to start with this one. I have two morphisms from A to omega, which are F and G. And on the other side, I can take Grothendieck constructions of F and the Grothendieck constructions of G. And after, I can pull them back along iota. So here I have iota etoile of the Grothendieck construction of F, and here iota etoile, the pullback of the Grothendieck construction of G. So in fact, when we are doing this kind of pullback, we don't change the underlying omega category, we just change the marking on this. In fact, there is less marked cell here than here. But the underlying omega category is the same. So I will explain some case when we have a trivial marking and a maximal one. But yeah, so the inference says that there is an equivalence between morphisms between the two pullback of the Grothendieck vibrations and marked Lax natural transformations. We have ATA. And I forget the marking. This should be some dot. Okay. So these diagrams are equivalent to this one. Okay, we have this big diagram. So I will explain a little bit, for example, what happens if we take, for example, the trivial marking. If we take the trivial marking, in fact, it means that we pull back along A flat to A sharp. And so it means that we have no more marked cell into X and Y. And so in fact, this just corresponds to a morphism between the underlying omega category. So if we take the trivial marking, in fact, it's just morphism that does not preserve the marking at all. This is on the left side. And on the right side, we get a natural transformation between F and G. But now, if we take, for example, the maximal marking, so everything is marked, on the left side, in fact, iota is the identity, and so we just have a morphism between X and Y. And on the right side, we just have a natural transformation. Okay, so in fact, if the morphisms preserve no marked cell, we get a Lax natural transformation. But if it preserves all the cells, we get a natural transformation. And so once again, we get a flexibility from the marking. And we have, and this is the last slogan of today. So by varying the marking on the left side, we continuously move from morphisms that does not preserve the marking, doesn't preserve the marking, to morphisms that preserve all the marking. All the marking. And on the right side, we continuously move from fully Lax natural transformation as before. To usual natural transformations. Okay, so we have this flexibility. How many cells do you want to preserve? How lax we want this operation to be? So yeah, so this is like kind of nice. And eventually, the last observation that I wanted to generalize to this new setting was the deep link between the Grothendieck constructions and the Lax colimit. So let F from A to omega be a functor from omega from the omega category of small category. Let TA be a marking on A. And we have I have a kind of a square. So here I have the Grothendieck constructions, A sharp. The domain of the Grothendieck constructions. Okay, so this is the Grothendieck constructions. And I can pull back along the canonical inclusions of ATA into A sharp, which is iota. So I forget to define it. We denote iota from ATA to A sharp, the canonical inclusions. Okay. So, and here I have iota étoile of the domain of the Grothendieck constructions of F. So now the link between Lax collimit and Grothendieck constructions, we have an equivalence between the Lax collimit of F over TA and this kind of pullback of the domain of the Grothendieck constructions, where I localized, yeah, so like this, by a Mach cell. Okay, so to get the Lax collimit, I just take the Grothendieck constructions and I crush all the Mach cells. And so, for example, if the marking is trivial, the Lax collimit of F over A is just equal to the domain of the Grothendieck fibrations after forgetting the marking. And if the marking is maximal, so here we have, if the marking is maximal, the notion of collimit becomes the notion of collimit. So collim over A of F is equal to the domain of the Grothendieck constructions after inverting all the Mach cells. Okay, so and it will be it's almost the end, so I think I still have 3 minutes. And so I think it will be enough to just give the demonstration, which is actually easy, of this equivalence in the case of a trivial marking. So we need to show that for C and omega category, the Lax collimit. Yeah, no, sorry. So I take F from A to omega. We have to show that the Lax collimit of F is equivalent to the domain of the Grothendieck constructions after forgetting the marking. So what do we have to show? We have to show that for all marked omega category C, sorry, for all omega category C, there is an equivalence between morphism between Lax collim F and C and natural transformations, Lax natural transformation between F and the constant functor with value C. Okay, so I take homomorphisms between the Lax collimit of F over A and C. So this corresponds, in fact, to a diagram of the following shape. So this is obvious because, in fact, it's just a triangle over the terminal category, so it just corresponds to morphisms. So here I have my Grothendieck constructions, where I forget the marking. I can pull back these morphisms along this one. And this corresponds to morphisms to C product with A. But the thing is, this corresponds in fact to the Grothendieck constructions of the constant functor with value C over A. And this is kind of easy to see because the fiber are all C and the transition function are like trivial. And this corresponds to, by the Lax univalence, to a Lax natural transformations between F and the constant functor with value C. Okay, so this concludes the proof and I think the presentations, and I think I'm over.
Thank you very much for this wonderful talk. So that's long. So any questions or comments? I think there is one chat. Thinking. So Emre has a question, I believe. Yes, Emre.
Thanks for the presentation. My question is the two translated object of the omega categories, that is the part of the you call the three category, is a three gray category. What I mean here, just roughly speaking, what is the third level of the omega categories? Is it just a tree category, or is it a special structure like a tree gray category?
Yeah. Okay, so no, in fact, it's a little bit more easy than gray category, in fact, because so I'm not expert into a gray category, but yeah. No, perhaps this is equivalent, infinity three category with gray category, I don't know. But the thing that I'm kind of sure is that the notion that I'm talking about, it's more easy. So for example, in fact, I don't know if I can give. For example, in fact, three categories in this setting are just category. So infinity three categories are category enriched. Into infinity two category. I don't know if it is true for gray category. In fact, perhaps you know. Yeah, so I'm not sure that this is I don't know how to compare the two these two
Okay. Are omega categories a model for homotopy types theory?
Our model for homotopy type theory? No, I don't think so. I don't
Thank
think
you.
because I think it's not a topos, for example. It's not an infinite topos at all, omega category. But one category are not a topos neither. So I don't think it's a model for the type theory.
Thank you.
But in fact, yeah, to yeah. The obstructions to be a model of, because a thing which we need to have in order to be a model of type theory is that the pullback should preserve colimit. And this is not true here. This is not true in category.
Any more questions or comments? So, Felix,
I have
yes,
one
Emre?
question.
Please.
Is it well? Can one construct a category from the markings themselves and make markings of markings further, a sort of further stratification?
Yeah, so for example, so if we are working with not omega category but just with marked infinity one category, it's true that we can define a marked omega category just to be two one category which are included one in the other. So you're right that we can define kind of sub-marked category of marking, but I don't know. Yeah, I don't know any kind of I like this kind of idea of stratifications of omega category, but I never thought about and I never see something like this. But this is like interesting idea.
Okay. Then, I mean, would your ideas also extend further along in that direction?
You mean like what could happen with this kind of stratifications?
Yeah, if we do that, then was the Lax colimit still definable in this new setting? And would it introduce new structures? in that case?
I'm sorry, I think I cannot answer this because I never thought about this, but I will definitely try to. But I have no, well, like this, I'm sorry, I have no idea of.
Okay, thank you.
But thank you for the idea, like I like.
You're welcome. Yeah.
Any more questions or comments? So we will read Felix's thesis and learn all these marking theory. Let's thank Felix once more. It was a really very nice, elegant talk, and we all wish Felix a very good time in Bonn. And
Thank you. I was really happy to talk in front of you.
actually, we are really happy that you talk here.
We
And
all
two
are happy.
weeks later, we will have a speaker from Portugal, actually. He's also running a TQFT seminar series in Portugal. John Huerta, he will going to speak. I don't know what he will talk. Still, he didn't send his title yet. But anyway, hope to see all of you 2 weeks later. And Happy New Year, by the way.
Yeah, thank you.
How, I hope you will have a successful 2024. Let's hope so. Yeah.
Well, I
Okay.
hope for you too.
See you all later.
Yeah, bye.
Bye-bye.